Well, hello and welcome to First Baptist Church. Hope you guys are doing well this morning. I want to read a passage of scripture for us up on the screen right now. It's John 4, 13 and 14. Not the correct verse I was looking for. Let's see here. Well, I don't have the verse up here. I guess it will show up when it's ready. Well, I'm glad you all are here. What we're going to do this morning is I'm going to pray for us before we begin. And then if the verse is up there, great. Unfortunately, I don't have it memorized, so I can't just quote it for you. But I would like to begin with prayer and pray for several people in our church who are sick right now and several other people who in our community who are hurting right now, especially with a shooting that took place recently. Right in our city. So why don't we pray right now for our church, for those who need health, but also for many in our community who are hurting right now. So if you would, bow your heads with me as we pray. Our Lord, we are thankful, Lord, for your provision for us. Lord, we are so humbled by the love that you show to us. Lord, we don't deserve it. There's nothing about us that deserves it. Lord, I want to pray, Lord, for those who are sick right now. Lord, those who need health, their health improved. Lord, we know that your plan through all this is good. And while we may not be able to see how it is good right now, or maybe we will in a year, whatever it is, Lord, I pray that first of all, we would trust in your sovereignty and trust in your plan. And Lord, I pray that, Lord, you would just comfort our community right now. I know there are several people who are afraid and angry at the shooting that took place yesterday. Lord, I don't know the condition of the person who was shot, Lord, but I pray for their family right now. I know they're hurting, and I pray that you would provide comfort and healing where it needs to be. And Lord, I pray that we as a church, in whatever way we can, even if it's just through a simple prayer, would be uplifting our community and to do our best to reach into our neighbors and our friends, our coworkers, our family, and to show the love and the light of Jesus Christ. And that would be our goal in all this, Lord, that we would be focused on sharing the love of Jesus Christ, even through something horrifying as this, and that the healing power in Jesus is greater than the evil in this world. I pray that we, Lord, we would trust that right now. So in the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. If you would please stand with me, together we're going to sing "There Is a Fountain."
Lose all their guilt.
take a moment and thank God with all of you for the provision for our church throughout this time. It's been a blessing. Thank you all for giving.
If you would like to continue to give, or if you want to give in a different way, online, you can go to give.fbcmish.org, and there you will be able to give online, or if you choose to do it in person, there's a box right over there next to Pastor Pete's office that you can slip something into right there. If you would pray with me, let's thank God right now. Lord, thank you for our church. Thank you for, Lord, the gifts that you've given us by jobs and by provisions, the way that you make that possible for our families and for us as a church. Lord, thank you for the giving of the people here. Lord, I pray that you would bless them in return. I pray that you would, Lord, bless the gifts that are given, that they would be used wisely, responsibly, and to further the cause of glorifying you in our church and in our community. And it's in the name of Jesus that I pray. Amen. Together, would you sing with me, Stricken, Smitten, and Afflicted?
When Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and more perfect tent, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation,
he entered once for all into the holy places, not by means of the blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of defiled persons with the ashes of a heifer sanctify for the purification of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through eternal spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Encouraging passage for us right now. Right now, let's sing about where our hope is found, and that is in Christ alone.
Take some personal moments right now to pray to God, asking God to soften our hearts for the preaching of the word this morning.
Lord, we come to you, inadequate sinners, constantly in need of mercy and grace, constantly in need of your Spirit to lead us. Lord, I want to humbly ask, Lord, that your Spirit would continue to guide us right now as we sing the next song, Wonderful, Merciful Savior, and as we enter into the worship through preaching. Lord, I pray that your Spirit would guide us, and that, Lord, your Spirit would interpret the truth, that it would apply the truth, and would lead us to different avenues of how we are able to grow in our faith and to understand more of your providence in our lives and understand the privileges that we have as followers of Christ. Lord, I pray that we would continuously, as this song says, fall before your throne every day. God, I ask that we would not think too highly of ourselves, but that we would admit and acknowledge our need of you every day, in every profession, in every situation, we need you. God, thank you for being so merciful to us. Lord, as we sing this, I pray that we would sing Wonderful, Merciful Savior, Lord, passionately and from our hearts without any hindrance on any part. And so it's in the name of Jesus I pray this. Amen. If you would join me in standing together.
Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
Right now, before the scripture reading and the sermon, Joseph Frerichs is going to come up and he's going to give us a brief ministry update on everything that's been going on with raising support. So Joseph, why don't you come on up and he's going to read scripture for us afterwards.
Bueno. Buenos días con todos, ¿cómo están? Gracias. My father-in-law said I should read the scripture out of the Spanish version, so, you know, I only brought my Spanish version up, so you guys, I'm kidding. Oh my word, you guys should have seen the faces out there. Okay, well, it's good to be back. It's great to be here. I've missed all of you guys so much. I've been on the road a ton, basically, this whole year, and honestly, it's been a really big blessing to see how God has continued to work through this entire year. Back in March 15th, we spoke at our last church out in Iowa, and then we had, you know, 6 to 7 months worth of churches scheduled back-to-back that we were going to go visit and share about our ministry with. And on my birthday, March 16th, we had 4.5 months worth of visits canceled, all in one day, all while I was driving back from Iowa to Indiana. And, you know, that hurt. That was really difficult. At that point in time, we were at 18% of our monthly support. We'd been praying that we'd be able to move at the beginning of 2021. And, you know, we were just very, very discouraged, very hurt, very just confused, wondering, you know, is this God's will for our lives? Is this where God is leading us? Are we following Him, or are we following our own hearts, our own desires? And so through all of that, God pushed us to our knees. You know, and we had to turn to Christ. We had to turn to Him and recognize that, you know, we have to completely depend on Him, completely rely on Him. And that changed everything. You know, that changed everything from our hearts, our motives, our passion, our drive. Everything that we were doing, you know, it changed because we were starting to pursue, you know, solely His glory. Whether that be, you know, moving to Peru next week or moving to Peru whenever He has it, you know, we're trying to follow His calling in our lives. And so we started praying that God would work and God would provide partners in our ministry. And it's been so cool to see over the last 6 months, God's brought along opportunities to be able to share about our ministry, but not only share about our ministry, but also help other churches in, you know, Indiana and Iowa with actual soccer camps, helping them share the gospel. We had one church in Indiana. It was in Washington, Indiana, just 2 or 3 weeks ago that we were able to share at. And five weeks ago, we were able to help them with a little camp. And so we had about 20 to 25 kids there 2 days back to back. We were able to coach them and then share the gospel with them. Some of them were from the church, some of them were from the school, but then some of them were friends that those kids had brought in alongside of them. And then August 8th, we were able to have our third annual Living Waters men's soccer tournament out in Iowa, the church that I used to go to before I moved here. When I was there, when I was doing college, I was running a soccer ministry out there, and so this was our third annual tournament. And the two prior years, we had between 40 and 50 people. And so I was thinking, oh my word, this is going to be even so much more difficult being here in Indiana trying to plan a tournament out there. And we ended up, we were planning for six teams. Six teams came along, and so we opened it. We pushed to eight teams. And we filled up eight teams of 10-plus people per team. And the last 2 days before the tournament, I had to turn down three other teams because there were so many people that were trying to show up. And so for our tournament that we had basically 6 hours worth of soccer at this church. And we were able to share the gospel. We were able to preach to them and connect with them and build relationships with them with over 120 people that day. And so it's been really cool to see how God's been working that way. We've also been able to continue to share a lot on Zoom. I kind of live on Zoom right now. God's provided that opportunity to be able to connect with people. I've shared with people in Washington State, in Maine. I've shared with people in Lima, Peru, just kind of everywhere. And it's been really cool to see how God has been working that way. And just this last week, we passed 65% of our monthly support. And so if you guys would continue to pray alongside of us, our prayer is that God would bring in 100% of our support by December with the goal of moving to Peru in March of next year so we can jump into the ministries there. Peru is really struggling right now. They have the highest restrictions in the world, alongside the highest death rate in the world. Their death rate is 5%. And so if you guys would be praying with me for Peru as well. I have a ton of friends there that have lost family members. Almost every single person I know has lost a family member there. So if you'd be praying for them and for the ministries there, we're praying that once we move to Peru, the ministries would really explode and be able to just really take off once everything gets back to normal. So sorry for taking so much time. I'm really excited and I'm really grateful for the part that you guys have in our ministry. Over the next 2 months, I'm going to be here a lot more. And so if you would like to hear a lot more about our ministry and how we're using soccer to share the gospel with people in Peru and in other countries in South America, please feel free to reach out to me. I would love to get coffee or lunch with you guys sometimes. So please feel free to connect with me about that. So getting back to the scripture, Hebrews 10, 19 through 25. In la versión Reina Valera 1960. Kidding, ESV. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with a pure heart. Let us hold fast with confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Thank you, guys.
All right, thank you, Joseph. Appreciate that. I'll tell you one thing. Many of you know about the Impact basketball that we do. So you may not be aware that Joseph and I had the privilege this last winter to start up a soccer version of that, so Impact Soccer. But we did that throughout the winter where we opened up the gymnasium. So basketball is on Thursdays from 4 to 6. And then we did indoor soccer through the winter, because we're not playing outside, from 7 to 9 in the evenings. And it started off a little bit slow. We had only probably the first night was like 15 people, and then we dropped down to 3 or 4, but then it began to grow and grow. And by the end, it was pretty consistent to where it was like 15 to 20 people, which too many more people, and we're like maxing out the gym for playing time and everything. But one of the things that was encouraging through that is we were able to have a tournament at the end of the year, which at the end of the season, like in March. And we were able to share the gospel, which was good, and made some good connections there. But even beyond that, what was encouraging to me is that Joseph texted me about maybe a month or maybe 2 months later, and he's like, hey, I'm trying to do, I got two guys from soccer who he played with on their team that he was doing a Bible study with, and they're not believers. And so that was encouraging to me that, you know, even from something like that, that's all it takes is befriending someone, playing a sport with them, having fun, playing a game, taking them out to coffee, whatever it is, and then just asking them, hey, can I do a Bible study with you? I want to talk a little bit about what something that I love and I'm very passionate about. And things get complicated through Zoom and everything, so I know that's tough. But it really is that simple to share the gospel. And just ask, hey, can we talk about this? This is important to me. So that was encouraging to me to see that. Boy, you guys are seeing a lot of me today. I'm sorry. Yeah, can't get rid of me right now. But I am excited to share the word this morning. Our passage is going to be from Hebrews. Before we get started into that, let me pray for us really quick. Our Lord, I am completely inadequate for this. I have nothing in and of myself that is deserving of preaching your word. I know that you want this passage preached this morning. I know that your spirit will work in me, and I pray that, Lord, the words that come out of my mouth would not be my preference, my opinion. I pray that this would be solely truth, and I pray that truth would pierce into our hearts, would divide into us and to, Lord, change us from the inside out. Lord, it's so easy for the temptation for us to become outside-in people, try to fix ourselves on the outside, to dress a certain way, to act a certain way, to get other people to look at us in a certain way, but That's not where change happens, God. And I know I'm tempted with that. I'm sure people in here are tempted with that. Lord, I just ask that through this text, Lord, we would see, Lord, the provision that you have given us in Jesus Christ and the blessings because of that, the privileges because of that. And I pray that as we hear this truth, God, that it would spur us on this week. It would encourage us this week and challenge us this week to not live ordinary lives. I pray that as we enter into this week, Lord, that we would be strengthened by your word and strengthened by your truth, and that we would be, Lord, drowning ourselves in prayer, and that we would have a passion for the word and passion for Jesus Christ so much that it just overflows out of us. And I pray that that would come from your word. So as we study your word, Lord, let us be focused. It's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen. Like I said, our study this morning is going to come from the book of Hebrews. Now, I chose Hebrews because it's a book I'm fairly familiar with, because this summer the teens and I went through a study on the book of Hebrews. We went through 1 week. Every Monday night we would do a chapter of the book of Hebrews. Going to drop this. A chapter from the book of Hebrews, and it was really encouraging. There was one main theme throughout the entire book that I made the teens say probably over 100 times over the course of the summer. What is it? I'll say it louder. There we go. Jesus is better. They will never forget that because I made him say that literally over 100 times. That's the theme of the book of Hebrews, is that this, Jesus is better. And what the author does is he begins at the beginning of Hebrews and he works through and he just compares Jesus to angels. Yep, Jesus is better than angels. And then he goes on to these historical figures. Yep, Jesus is better than those. And then he goes on to later in the book, and he goes to, is Jesus better than even the priests of the Old Testament, which were highly respected, highly motivated people who loved God? Was Jesus, yes, Jesus was better than even those. And in fact, as we see here in our text, Jesus is referred to as the great high priest. So we have the priests, and then we have the great high priest. So the theme of the book, Jesus is better. Our text today does a very full job, not complete, but a full job of summarizing the majority of the message of the book of Hebrews. So the big idea from our passage today, because of God's provision through Jesus, Christians have the privilege of drawing near to God, enduring in their faith, and uplifting one another. So before we get into the actual message, let me tell you about Alec Holden. Alec Holden, maybe you've heard of him. This was big news a while ago, about 10 years ago. On April 24th, 1997, Alec Holden of Great Britain turned 90 years old. On that day, he placed the equivalent of a $200 bet that he would live to be 100 years old. So he was betting that he would live 10 more years. A betting company had placed Holden's odds at 250 to 1. So on April 24th, 2007, when he turned 100, he collected on his bet the equivalent of 50,000 British pounds. That's a lot of money. I'll just to see if he would make it to be 100. He was a jokester. Holden, who worked both as a teacher and a carpenter through much of his life, credited porridge as his number one source of survival. He also confessed that in the days leading up to the big payoff, he was very careful and frequently reminded himself to keep breathing. Sometimes life just gets hard and you got to remind yourself to keep breathing. It paid off. It paid off for him because he walked away from a $200 bet to a $50,000 pound. I don't know the difference there. I don't know that. But, you know, sometimes life gets so hard, you just have to remind yourself to keep breathing so you can get that big payoff in the end. So what do you do during those times when life gets that kind of hard? What do you do to defeat discouragement when it enters into your life that sometimes it's just so strong that it takes your breath away? Maybe you've been there, maybe even recently, where you just feel like there's little to no hope. Maybe you've been through those seasons of difficulty where you just feel the pressures of life just bearing down on you. What do you do when you feel like quitting? Well, that's where Hebrews 10:19-25 comes into play, where we have a call to remember God's providence, but we also have a call to enact and live out the privileges that you and I have been given. Like I said, this passage right here is the core, a summary paragraph of the whole book addressed to you and me, or the original readers, but also to you and me, the people who are tempted to lose focus in their faith in Christ because of the hardships they're experiencing. So within verses 19-25, we will see how God has provided for us the great high priest, and also we'll see the privileges that we now experience because of God's provision. So, first, the provision of God through his priest. To start it off, the first provision of God through his priest is very simply from the text, we have confidence to enter the holy places. Here's how God works. He provided the blood of Jesus to allow entrance to the presence of God. Under the old way, it was only one man. I'm sure many of you are familiar with these procedures, but it was only one man once a year who could enter into the presence of God. Now, that man was the high priest from the old ways, but there was so many procedures he had to go through and so many cleansing rituals and so many different things he had to do to prepare himself to enter into this place. But he would, one day a year, on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, you always see that on your calendars, I always have it on my calendars stapled there, Yom Kippur, and he would wash himself completely, then enter the holiest of the holy places in the temple. There he would meet with God behind a very thick veil. Nobody else could go in there. Then Jesus, once again, who is better, Jesus is better, died on the cross, and that huge veil that separated man and God was now ripped in two, gone. From the top to bottom, his body was broken, blood was shed, it opened a way for us at any time to be in the presence of God, never being too far, never being out of his reach. William Fry, he was a retired Episcopal bishop from Colorado. He talks about a time in a book when he volunteered to read to a blind college student named John. So one day, William Fry, he asked John, "How did you lose your sight?" So John replied, "It was a chemical explosion when I was 13. "So how did that make you feel?" Fry asked him. John responded, "Life was over. I felt helpless. I hated God. For the first 6 months, I did nothing to improve my lot in life. I would eat all my meals alone in my room. One day, my father entered my room and said, 'John, winter's coming and the storm windows need to be put up. That's your job. I want those hung by the time I get back this evening or else.' Then he turned, walked out of the room, and slammed the door. So John said, I got so angry. I thought, who does he think I am? I'm blind. I was so angry, I decided to even do it. I felt my way to the garage, found the windows, located them, and decided to put them up. He found the ladder, all the while muttering underneath his breath, 'I'll show them. I'll fall, and then they'll have a blind and paralyzed son.' John continued, I got the windows up. I found out later that never at any moment was my father more than 4 or 5 feet away from my side." We all have difficult times. It will look different for each one of us. We all have times when God just feels distant and unknowable, and we'll have other times where he feels intimate and close. Moments where you know God is there, but you just don't feel him working, or at least in the ways you want him to. In times like these, remember, you are always, always in the presence of your Heavenly Father. He's never far away. No matter how difficult a task it is that our God has given you, he's never far away. He's there comforting you when you don't even think you need it. One of the highlighted themes of Hebrews is how in tune Jesus is with our suffering, because he suffered in the exact same ways. He's familiar with our sufferings. He groaned like us. He's there right by your side. That's what Jesus has done for you. Because of God's provision through Jesus, we have confidence to enter into God's presence. But not just that, we have the great high priest. So not only do we have provision, which allows us access to the presence of God, God's provision has placed Jesus over the house of God, which is encouraging. So not only is Jesus our Savior by his shed blood, he is also our security before God. Praise God that he's our security and not our own selves. Am I right? We'd be in trouble. Paul Ellingworth, who's a commentator, summarizes this verse in a very helpful way. Let me read this for you. What then is the meaning of this verse? By means of his self-offering, Christ has done perfectly and in reality for us what the Levitical high priest did imperfectly and figuratively. He gained access by a new way to the living God, not only for himself, but for all through him who will share life in God. Maybe you have people in your life that come up to you and they let you know, hey, I'm praying for you, or I'm praying for your family. I have several of you and several people that come up to me, or they'll text me and be like, hey, I'm praying for you today to be strong, to grow. That's so encouraging. I don't know how you guys feel about that, but that's really encouraging to me when I hear that. What is even more encouraging and even humbling is the fact that we have Jesus right now praying for us on our behalf, interceding for us on our behalf. Right now, Jesus is praying for you. In those moments of struggle and trials, and when you feel like giving up, and when you feel like God is so distant, and when you see that in your own life that God is just this foreign concept that you can't even see, you can't touch, you can't taste, it's gone. Jesus is still there interceding for you on your behalf, groaning for you, longing to be near to you. This is one of those truths that sometimes you just need to be quiet and believe and trust. To trust that you have a great high priest over the house of God who is your security. It's so humbling to be loved by Jesus. When you place your faith in Jesus Christ, he brings you from death to life by the sacrifice of his own life. He makes you a new creation. He ushers you into the presence of God. He disciples you through the Holy Spirit, made a way for you to have the Holy Spirit, welcomes you into his church, forgives you, accepts you back when you sin daily. That's Jesus, and that's the provision of God through his great high priest. That's a blessing. That's something that we cannot overlook. But it also, to end this portion, I would like to have you remember this, is that there will be so many times, even maybe it's recently, maybe it'll be in the distant future, but sometimes when you get so discouraged, you just need to pray and remember truth. Read this passage. Be comforted by the fact that you have a Savior who is interceding on your behalf. When you sit down to pray and you don't even know what to pray, I've had moments like that recently and within the last couple of months with everything going on, where I sit down and I am just like, I don't even know what to pray right now. I'm lost. Help. I don't know if you guys have ever been there, but sometimes it's okay to just trust in the truths of Scripture and let that be. I understand difficulty. There are so many other people that go through struggles like this that understand difficulty, which is why it's humbling to know that we have a great high priest who loves you deeply. Now, what's interesting is our passage takes a little bit of a turn. So in the first couple of verses, we have truth. This is it. This is the truth about Jesus Christ. We now enter into God's presence. The veil is torn. We have Jesus, who's this great high priest. Now, because of God's provision over here, there's a shift in the verses from verses 19 to 21. Now, rather than focusing on what God did through Jesus, now we are given some privileges of things we get to do because of Jesus. So the shift is this. This is what Jesus has done. Now, because of this, this is what you do in light of this. So the privileges of the follower of Jesus are threefold. First privilege, we have the privilege of drawing near to God. Verse 22, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. To draw near is a verb. It's an action, which is actually what worship is. Worship is pursuing God. Here's where many people get stuck. They think that worship is attending a church service on Sunday and singing songs and hearing preaching and then going home. The truth is, those things are worship, but they are a small part of worship. And in fact, just because you attend a church and sing some songs doesn't mean that you actually worshiped. True worship is the submission to and the pursuit of God in everything you do. Did you know you can come to Sunday morning worship, sing songs even loudly, and still be bitter? You guys ever experienced that before? Like you leave church and you're still angry? Oh, it didn't work. I've been through that several times. I get it. Worship is much more than just this hour and a half time slot right now. This is a part of it. It is important. In fact, we talk about that a little bit later, to not neglect this, some things like this. But worship is so much more. It's about everything you do. If you notice, in verse 22, it says that we are to draw near to God in full assurance of faith. You know what I'm thankful for? I am so thankful that this verse does not read, draw near to God with a true heart in full assurance of your own ability. We would be done. We'd be done. Instead, this verse tells us to draw near in full assurance in nothing of what we have done, but instead in full assurance of what we just read of the truth previously, full assurance of Jesus Christ, who is our security over the house of God. This is what we just looked at a few minutes ago. Your confidence of faith needs to be placed in the great high priest who is sitting over the house of God, the one who is familiar with the suffering, with your sufferings, and the one who can actually do something about your sufferings. Why? Why do you think it's so important that your full assurance of faith is placed in Jesus rather than yourself? Why? I'll tell you why. Because when you get cut off in traffic, you get angry. Maybe say some things you shouldn't, but no one will know because you're in your car and you're alone. Well, when someone says something offensive towards you, you're tempted to hold bitterness in your heart, maybe even lash out in anger. When someone pays no respect to your opinion or to you, your pride comes bursting through like a freight train, ready to belittle that person and mock them. Placing your full assurance of faith in yourself will fail, because you will fail. It's not a question of when or if, it's a question of when. Placing your full assurance of faith cannot be in yourself. It needs to be in something much stronger, much more firm, immovable, eternal. That's why it's in Jesus. Jesus doesn't fail. He doesn't sin. He doesn't give in to temptation. He loves perfectly. He sacrifices perfectly. He perfectly counts others more significant than himself. Draw near to God in full assurance that Jesus has provided you that opportunity. That's a privilege. The privilege of the follower of Jesus. Let me ask you a question. It's very easy to say when you're asked the question, well, do you love the Bible? Yes. It's very easy to say, yes, I love the Bible. Of course I love the Bible. But let me ask you a different question. And this will help us here. Do you value God's word? Allow me to encourage you with this. Draw near to God by specifically saturating your mind and heart with God's word. Now, notice I say specifically saturating. That takes time. It takes effort. You have to specifically set aside times throughout your day, throughout your week, to commune with God, and it has to be on purpose and not just accidental. And it's not going to be convenient. all the time. Spend time getting to know more of God on a regular basis. This is drawing near to God. The more you get to know the heart of God, the more your heart will begin desiring that kind of heart rather than desiring a sinful heart. The more you drown your mind with the word, the closer God will begin to feel. The deeper the connection between you and God by his word, the more you will want to run from temptation and run to God. So let me ask you again, do you value God's word? Because it will reveal itself in your life. Drawing near to God is a privilege. This will help you answer, help you determine whether or not you're drawing near to God, this question. So pay attention. Do you look at the word of God, drawing near to God, do you look at this as a necessity for your life, or do you look at it as a burden? When you think about spending time with God, when you think about spending time in prayer, do you look at that as a burden, or do you look at it as, I need this? I think honestly answering that question might help you determine whether or not you are drawing near to God. I understand that there are some days where it's just like you're tired, you just want to sleep, and spending time in the Word, not such a high priority sometimes. And there's other times you're ready to dive into it and do this study, and you're pulling out 20 different books trying to study it. I get that. There's ups and downs. But yeah, honestly answer that question in your heart. This will help you understand, do I long to draw near to God? And if not, how can I begin praying that I will? Well, let me encourage you. Start by prioritizing every day in the Word. One chapter. One chapter does not take very long, but I promise you, once again, saturating your mind with that truth every day, beginning to purify your thoughts, putting them through the filter of Scripture, this will encourage you, it will challenge you, it will be humbling, but it provides life. It provides life for you that we need desperately. So the first privilege of the follower of Jesus is drawing near to God. The second privilege of the follower of Jesus is not quitting. Don't quit. Verse 23 says, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Did you know that it is a privilege to not quit? Why would it be a privilege to not quit? Well, because if it weren't for Jesus saving you in the first place, you wouldn't even have the choice. You wouldn't even be in the race. You wouldn't even be in this on this journey. You'd still be dead in your trespasses and sins. Therefore, it is a privilege to endure, and it's a privilege to not quit. Again, we are reminded that holding on to this hope in Jesus is not based on our own steadfastness. Rather, it's based upon God's faithfulness to us. God will never go back on his word. You can trust him to keep his promises no matter what. So don't give up. Don't give up. Don't quit. Don't lose your hope, because God will come through for you every time. It may look differently than what you want, but God will come through for you every time. So when you're facing the difficulties of life, don't quit on God. Encouraging verse, Luke 12:31, seek the kingdom of God above all else, and he will give you everything you need. Notice he does not say he will get you everything you want. You're not getting every desire of your heart, but you will get everything you need. Psalm 34:10, the lion may grow weak and hungry, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. God will always provide for you. Don't quit. Please, don't quit in this journey. And I'll tell you what, God's provision will sometimes shock you in ways that you never, ever saw coming. Last week, many of you know, I got in a car accident last week and got T-boned by one of the largest trucks I've seen on the road. It was not fun. I do not recommend. Don't quit in your faith, because God is faithful even before you think you need him. In the immediate seconds after I got hit in my car, and my car flung around, and knee-jerk reaction, I immediately looked in my back seat. It's where my kids usually are. Thankfully, they weren't there. But I looked in my back seat, and God's provision for me there before I even knew it was that my kids weren't in that seat, those seats, because I looked back, and my daughter's seat, which is where the directly where the impact was folded completely sideways. It was still in one piece, but the seat was completely folded sideways, and it was starting to bend in a little bit, and the door where I got hit was practically sitting inside of the seat. And so God's provision right there before I even knew I really needed it was that my kids weren't in the car. On top of that, I was able to get up and walk away from the accident. Couple of bumps, couple of bruises, when in reality, there could have and shouldn't have been worse injuries. I used to drive a tiny little Toyota Corolla. This is a GMC Sierra. If you know trucks, it's a very big truck. And could have been a lot worse. But God's provision for me, before I even realized it and knew it, was that I got to walk away. And everyone involved got to walk away as well. And on top of all of that, within 1.5 hours of the incident, and right after I was talking with God, I got off the phone with my insurance company, and I was briefly, like 5 seconds, God, I don't know how you're going to work through this or how you're going to come through for me, but guess what? Within 5 minutes of that short little doubting prayer of 5 seconds, God had provided us a new car. That's humbling. Don't quit, for he who promised is faithful. Before you even realize you need him, he's there for you. That's our second privilege of being followers of Jesus Christ, is that we get to not quit. Don't quit. He who promised is faithful. The final privilege of the follower of Jesus is this, to deliberately encourage one another. Verses 24 and 25, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. To consider means to give concentrated thought to. So it means to stop, observe, and think. How can I encourage my fellow brothers and sisters by what I say and what I do? This requires you to be alert, focused in on the needs of others around you. To spur, it means to incite, to provoke, or to encourage, to prod one another toward love, towards Jesus, toward Scripture, toward prayer, toward Christian fellowship. We're supposed to spur each other onto these things. It's funny, in the Greek, obviously there's no direct translate, like direct equivalent to words. To spur in Greek actually means to annoy. And this is like one of only two times in the entire New Testament that it's used in a positive sense. So most of the time when it's talking about spurring, it's like you're supposed to be annoying and like troublesome. Now it's telling you, be annoying about encouraging people to get in their Bible. I would not encourage you to be annoying about this. Maybe be encouraging about it. But that's the force that's getting behind you. Spur others on to this. Consider how to do this. Push people towards Christ. Jesus is coming soon, so let's get together as often as we can. Let's get together so we can spur one another to love and good works. During the Great Depression, 9 ordinary young men from the University of Washington accomplished an extraordinary feat. They labored together in a brand new rowing program to take on a much stronger rowing programs like Cal Berkeley, Harvard, Yale, the big schools of the time. In his book, The Boys in the Boat, by Daniel James Brown, he describes what the boys' coach saw as they worked for each other towards this goal of winning this race. He heard them declare their dreams, confess their shortcomings. He learned to see where hope brought the boys where there was no hope. He observed the fragility of confidence and the redemptive power of trust. And then Brown details the grueling training schedules these guys went through. This is a brand new rowing program. They were up early in the mornings. They were up late at nights doing workouts. They had lacking of money. Every one of them wanted to quit at some point in time during the season. Then he tells the coach discovered. As all 9 friends fought for their dream, he discovered that the mystical bonds of trust and affection if nurtured correctly, might lift a crew above their ordinary sphere, transported to a place where nine boys somehow became one thing, so in tune that as this team rowed, effort was replaced by ecstasy. It was a rare thing. So in 1936, those nine young men took their rowing shell, the Husky Clipper, you can Google it, the Husky Clipper, to Hitler's Germany to take on the world in the Olympics. And they brought home the gold. This is a beautiful picture of what the church should be. It's ordinary people coming together to spur each other on to extraordinary things, to consider how to challenge and encourage each other to reach out to their community and to reach out to their friends with the gospel. It's people who share their shortcomings and dreams. The church should be people that share their failures and share their victories. It's people who sometimes feel like quitting on each other, maybe even sometimes feel like quitting on God. But together, we find a way to replace effort with ecstasy and take on the world with the power of God. You can't do that alone. I know several people that are currently trying and have tried to do this alone. You're limiting yourself. You're limiting what God will do in your life. God will work no matter what. He does not need you to do it, but he chooses to use you to do it. And that should be humbling, but also be that's also comes with a responsibility, a privilege to deliberately encourage one another, because you need that encouragement as well. You can't do it alone, so get together with God's people. Don't neglect your gathering together, especially as the days get harder and harder before Jesus comes again. Now, before my phone is about to blow up or I get text messages, I'm not necessarily talking about physically getting together all the time, although worship is important and physical gatherings is important. But we'll get there. We'll get there. Let me encourage you with this. Gathering together does not have to be in person. It can be through the phone. That's one of the beauties of technology, you know. With COVID, we've had to get a little creative on how we stir and spur one another up to good works and love. But it is still possible. Absolutely. If you're wondering how you can do it, grab your phone and give someone a call and see how their day is going. It is that simple. 30 seconds of your day. Hey, man, I was thinking about you. Love you. Bye. That's it. It could be that quick. Or if you have a few more minutes, all it takes is one of the apps on your phone, FaceTime, Duo, Zoom. You can video call someone and just say, hey, this is something God's been teaching me. You don't need to say anything. I just want to give you some encouragement and pray with you. You can do that within 5 minutes on your phone. Easy. Could meet up at a local trail. Keep your distance. Go outside. Go for a walk with someone. Talk about possible ways that our church could effectively and creatively reach into our community. I'd love that. Maybe write an encouraging letter. Maybe find someone's email. Find a friend. Share what you read in God's Word. Share a Bible verse. Pray with them. Let them know how God is changing you. Or let them know, hey, I'm struggling. Can you pray with me? This is what the church is for, to deliberately encourage one another. That is ordinary people coming together to spur each other on to love and good works. And I love how this passage kind of ends it off with, like, Jesus is coming. You don't have time to lose. Don't waste your life. Don't waste time saying, it's just too awkward. Or, it feels weird to randomly call someone up and pray with them. Okay. It felt weird when you were first learning to walk, but you needed to do it. Right? Kind of important. Prayer is a vital piece of equipment for the believer. I get it. It may just feel a little bit weird at times, but it's also one of the biggest blessings that we can do with people. Even more so with the Word. We can share the Word. We can call each other and share the word. We can go on a walk and share the word. We can sit down and share the word. We can go grab coffee. I love coffee. So if you ever want to get coffee and share the word, I'm down. Let's do it. But these are things that we're supposed to do. These are privileges of the Father of Jesus Christ. We have the ability to draw near to God. We have the privilege of not quitting. Don't quit. And then we get to deliberately encourage one another. Think about these things. Let these things seep into your heart and mind. And I pray that as we go throughout this week, that we would enact these things, that we would draw near to God, that we would continue steadfast in our faith, and that we would be deliberate to encourage one another. Our God, Lord, we are thankful for how you love us. Thank you, Lord, that you provided for us through Jesus. Lord, your provision through Jesus allowed us to draw near to you. It allows us to endure in our faith, and it allows us to deliberately uplift one another and encourage one another. God, I pray that this week in my own life, you would humble me to do just this, to draw near to you because of the sacrifice of Jesus, to endure in the faith. Lord, I pray that you would, Lord, give me the discipline, but also, Lord, the desire and the continued love, Lord, to reach out to people. And I pray that other people would do the same, that we would specifically, lovingly target people this week to share the love of Christ with, whether it's inside the church or outside the church. And I pray that would be said of us, that we, our love that we have for each other, that we would be known for that in our community. And it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. And you still didn't get rid of me. Please stand back up. We're going to sing one closing song together. We're going to sing the gospel song. Thank you so much for songs that we get to sing truth to you. Even when we don't feel like it, it's still an encouragement to do. Lord, again, as this week, as we enter into it, Lord, give us the focus, give us the determination by your Spirit to enact your word, to live it out, and to draw near to you by your word. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Before we play the video, there's an announcement in the video that I guess needs to be changed. I talked about sow and reap happening this Tuesday night. It's not. So that little 10-second clip in the video, just ignore it. Thank you.
Hey, First Baptist family. Let's talk about what's going on at our church. Next week, September 20th, Ivan and Tanya Largen will be joining us for worship. They're one of our missionaries that we support, and they will be providing us with a brief update about their ministry in Uruguay, South America. Tomorrow at 11 a.m., Virginia Curran's funeral will be held at Palmer Funeral Home, which is formerly known as Bub Funeral Home on Main Street. Ladies, this week, Sow and Reap will be meeting once again on Tuesday evening at 6 p.m. Now, we've chosen to keep the bulk of our ministry gatherings to Sunday mornings because of COVID. However, beginning in October, we plan to bring back our Sunday night ministries, including Awana. So, the very first week in October is when we are planning on reopening all of our Sunday evening ministries. To all of the men who are a part of our church, Man Camp is coming up quickly. So as a reminder, Man Camp is not just limited to fathers and sons. This is for any male in the church that wants to come and eat some good food and camp out with us. Man Camp will be located at Potato Creek State Park and it's taking place September 25th and 26th. The cost is $10 a person, or if you're not too keen on spending the evening outside, the cost is just $5 for dinner on Friday night. So if you're wanting to come, try to bring a friend. This is a great way to get people connected with our church. Please be sure to let me know ahead of time if you are coming. I'm looking forward to this, and I hope you are too. Lastly, if you're new here at First Baptist Church, thank you so much for choosing to worship with us. If you stop by our guest center in the annex, you can pick up one of the gifts that we have set out for you. Have a great week, First Baptist.